Hello and welcome. Please sing with us. It's the same fight over again.
Thank you. Hello.
Hey. Oh, no problem.
I just wanted to play piano for a second.
Welcome to the journey, everybody. My name is Josh. We are all about loving God and loving people humbly, boldly, and authentically. It's a really nice day outside, so it might have been a hard decision to come inside, but thank you for joining us. We're glad you're here. Now, if you didn't get a bulletin, you might want to sneak out and get one. You can get up during the service, grab snacks or drinks or whatever is out there. I'm not sure what's out there right now. But definitely grab one of these. It's a program. It tells you kind of what's going on. And it actually also has a little card in it, so you can follow along, take notes. But if you need anything, if you have questions, or just want to tell us your opinion about the journey, please just fill this out, and nobody's going to contact you unless you ask us to. But let's say you want to have a question, or you need help with something, or prayer for something. That's what these are for. So grab one of these if you don't have one. There are also a list of upcoming events in the Journey Church. One of those would be small groups, and we've got Kickstarter. That's Mondays at 6. Family group Mondays at or Thursdays at 6, and then the letters, which I think is a new one, that's starting at 6:30 on Thursdays, not here, but at another location. So that's all in here. You can check that out. And what else have we got? We do monthly meetups. And what do we got going on for monthly meetups this week? Second Sunday potluck, which is actually the third Sunday potluck, and it's today. So stay and partake in that. That'll be cool. Quarters in the washers. We're doing a cool meetup where we're going to put quarters in people's washing machines and just pay for their load of wash for them. That's kind of fun. And Ladies Aid is coming up too. So that'll be pretty cool. And again, the details are all in here. We don't pass a plate around here. That's not how we roll. If you want to give and support the mission of the journey, you can do that online, or you can drop it in the basket. Also, if you have a card you fill out and have a question, you can drop that in the basket too. Another way that we serve others here is all kinds of things. Right now we're looking for somebody to help with infants, for instance. There are lots of things that you can do to help out here, to help the community, to help a journey home. And if you want to get involved, talk to Devin, and he'll hook you up with the person that you need to talk to. So one last thing, invite your friends here. We think this is pretty cool, and the little family that we've got going on here is really neat. So if you know people that you think might be interested, invite them next Sunday. You can do that in person, obviously, or you can use our Facebook page. We always send out invites to church, and you can share that with your friends. So that's pretty cool, easy, two-click way to do that, and that works really well. So with that, let's get back to, yes, children. After. Yeah, now. Shh. Secret. I'll tell you later. Okay. All right. Let's worship some more. Thanks.
I'm
now the kids are dismissed. Well, they are already pretty much left, which is cool. They were all up in the front row worshiping, so we decided that kind of last minute there that they would stay and worship. So there is no infant nursery, whatever you want to call it, today because it fell through. Somebody had something they had to take care of. So listen, we could use some more people who are interested in doing the nursery ministry or the infant ministry. So if you are interested in that, please see Paula. She will get you on the schedule. We'd love to have more people involved. So that would be awesome. In fact, if you want to do any of the kid ministries or anything going on around here, whether it be tech or whatever, we would love to have you involved. So, you know, come and visit with me or with Paula, and we can set you up in the right place to let you know some areas that need some help. So that being said, thanks for coming. We're glad that you're here. We're glad that you're worshiping with us today. I can smell the deliciousness out there already, so I'm excited about that. It's going to be fun. Hope you can stick around for that. We do typically a second Sunday, kind of a potluck thing where you bring some food and stuff. But we had so much snow last week that I had to travel from house to house to eat. So that was no, I didn't do that. But so we just had to put it to this week. So that's what we're doing. And if you brought food, that's awesome. If you did not bring food, that's okay too, because you can stick around. There's plenty of food out there. I've been eyeing it most of the afternoon, and there's plenty. So please stay and hang out and enjoy food with us. We're glad you're here. We're glad that you're part of the journey. And I pray that you know that you matter, and that you matter to us, you matter to God. We are beginning a brand new series today. I'm excited for it. It's simply titled David. There's a lot of great men in history. I believe that there's a lot of them, and all of them have achieved some great things, and they all have their flaws, except for Jesus, of course. But when I say great men, who comes to mind? I'm just curious. Some people are thinking maybe George Washington, maybe, or Abraham Lincoln. Great men, definitely. Some of you who are, you know, really spiritual, you're going to say Jesus. Good, that's true. Great man. And I don't know why this is, but for me, when I think of great men, I just was thinking of Michael. You say, Michael? Michael who? Well, there's a lot of great Michaels. I was thinking of a lot of different Michaels that are great. In fact, there's so many great Michaels that I thought we should play a game called, what did I title this one? Help me out. Where's the game slide thing with the, I gave it a great name. Oh, name that guy. Whoops. Chris, you might have to help with that. Name that guy. And I'll give you a hint. His name is Michael. Okay, so here's how we're going to do it. That's how this game is played. We need to just change that back so it fixes that. So here's what we're going to do. I'm going to show you a very teeny tiny, somebody's going to show you a very teeny tiny picture of something, and you just kind of pop out, who is that Michael? Okay? Very simple. And the winner gets to go first in line or something. I don't know. We'll figure it out. Ready? Here we go. First picture. Come on. Super easy. Michael Jordan. I gave you the easiest one first because it's just too easy. So that, of course, is a great man, Michael Jordan. Okay? So here's the next one. Pretty simple, too. Michael Jackson. Yes, that is correct. All right. We'll keep moving. What is it? Vic. Yep, that is correct. Michael Vick. Fantastic football player. All right, here we go. Ooh, I'm impressed. Michael Phelps. See, I tried to make him harder as we went along, so... All right, that was definitely Michael Phelps. How about that one?
Michael Douglas.
Oh, wow, you guys are good. Indeed, that is Michael Douglas. How about this one here? Wow, I heard it. Somebody said it. Oh, in the back, Michael J. Fox. She knew it. Excellent. How about this one here? No one?
Michael, American
Second. Nope. Nope. That is. That's Michael Helmrich, your cousin. I had to make it so you couldn't get them all. Come on, lighten up. All right, we're not talking about Michael today. Let's get back to it. We're talking about David. David was a great man, a great boy, a great king, a great leader, really. So I want to look at his life and what he can teach us through his life, how his life can be kind of an example to us. And most of us know a little bit about David. We know a little bit about, you know, the David and Goliath, and David was a king, and yada, yada. We know that stuff. But I want to look a little deeper into the life of David. So here's the intro to David, kind of summarized, okay? There were no kings in Israel, and only judges, because that's the way that God wanted it. So back in the day, you got to kind of picture it. There are no kings, not in this land anyway, not in Israel. There's judges, and God wanted it that way. And the people started begging, give us a king. We want a king. We all want a king. Some of the nations around us have kings, and we think we should have a king. And God said, no, don't. This is going to get ugly. That's Devin's paraphrase, of course. He said, it's going to get ugly. You don't want a king, because kings abuse power, and they tax us, and it's not going to be good. And they continued to beg and push, and they insisted. So God anointed Saul to be the first king of Israel. Now, Saul of the Old Testament, not Saul that changed his name to Paul or anything in the New. This is Saul, King Saul, back in the Old Testament. It says in 1 Samuel, it says, Saul was 30 years old when he became king, and he reigned for 42 years. So the very first king of Israel, and he starts off doing pretty good. God anointed him, God called him, said, this is what I want you to do, you're going to be the king. And at first, for the first couple of years, Saul did what he was supposed to do. And then his true nature kind of started shining through. Saul, instead of serving, decided that he would be selfish, and he would start doing things a little bit his way. So first there was Saul. He's the very first king. But the second king is David. He was the second king. Two very different people, both chosen by God. Now, the Philistine army had gathered thousands of warriors to oppose Saul and Israel. And God has protected them over and over again. God has protected the Israelites because they're his chosen people. He did that. And the Philistines have come up with this huge army, and they're going to come and attack. And Saul starts freaking out. And Samuel, the prophet, now you know what a prophet is. A prophet is somebody who hears from God and then tells other people what God says. So Samuel's the prophet, and the whole book is named really after Samuel. Okay, so Samuel is told by God what they're supposed to do, and then Samuel tells Saul, who is the current king, what he's supposed to do. Okay, so Samuel, the prophet, was supposed to arrive and do an offering to God before they went into battle. But the troops were getting closer and closer, and so Saul was freaking out a little bit. He's like, you know, they're getting closer. Samuel's not here. He's supposed to do this offering to God, and then God will protect us. And he's not here, so I think I'm just going to do this offering myself. And that's exactly what he does. Samuel, he makes an offering to God, but he's not supposed to do that. In doing that, he disobeys directly what God tells him to do. And it says it here. It says in 1 Samuel, it says, Samuel exclaimed, he arrived right after this offering. He arrived right after Saul did it. Samuel arrived, and he says to Saul, he says, how foolish, Samuel exclaimed. You have not kept the command the Lord your God gave you. Had you kept it, the Lord would have established your kingdom in Israel forever. But now your kingdom must end, for the Lord has sought out a man after his own heart. The Lord has already appointed him to be the leader of his people because you have not kept the Lord's command. See, over and over again in Scripture, throughout the Bible, really, we see people who do what God tells them to do. They obey God, and there are blessings. And then there are other people who disobey God, and they do what they're not supposed to do, and the consequences, they're devastating. They really are painful. So in chapter 16, we're introduced to this boy named David. It says, "Now the Lord said to Samuel, 'You have mourned long enough for Saul. I have rejected him as king of Israel. So fill your flask with olive oil and go to Bethlehem and find a man named Jesse who lives there, for I have selected one of his sons to be my king.' But Samuel asked, 'How can I do that? If Saul hears about it, he will kill me. Take a heifer with you.'" God said, I don't know, maybe I'm weird. But I find that somewhat amusing. Okay, God, here's what you want me to do. But Saul's going to kill me. This is a bad plan. I'm going to die. I don't like it. Well, bring a cow. Turns out the cow was a sacrifice. It's kind of Samuel's thing. It's what's supposed to happen, and it does happen that way. And so Samuel brings a cow, and everybody thinks he's just going to make a sacrifice somewhere, so they're not worried about it. So he goes on to see Jesse and to talk to him and find out, you know, okay, who's this son that God is anointing to be the king? He goes to the house of Jesse. Again, I think that's kind of awesome. I think we should promote things like that from now on. You know, there's a new small group starting up on Thursday nights at the house of Susie. So just if you're, yeah, house of. Jesse presents his sons to the prophet Samuel. Goes like this. "When they arrived, Samuel took one look at Eliab and said, 'Surely this is the Lord's anointed.' But the Lord said to Samuel, 'Don't judge by his appearance or height, for I have rejected him. The Lord doesn't see things the way you see them.'" Watch this. "People judge by outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart." Catch that. "People judge by outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart." God doesn't see things the way that we see things. God looks at the heart. Man looks at the outside appearance and what it looks like and judges and makes an idea, but God looks at the heart. We'll come back to that later. Samuel goes through each of Jesse's sons. "Well, it must be this one." Nope, that's not the one, God tells him. "Well, it must be this one." Nope, that's not the one. So they get all the way through all of these sons of Jesse, and it's not any of those. He said, "Is there anybody left?" Yeah, there's David. But David is so unimportant that he's not even here for this thing. He's out tending sheep. He's out watching the lambs. That's what he's doing. They're having this big deal with Samuel there. Samuel's a prophet that's known across the land. And David's not even there. They don't expect David to be the one that Samuel's going to anoint. So he's not even invited. So they wait for him, and they send for him. Go get David. Long story short, they go get him, and sure enough, he's the one that God chose to be king. But he's just a boy, and the timing isn't right. So he doesn't, you know, we might picture, he doesn't get a crown at this moment. He doesn't go take the throne. He doesn't start making rules as we might expect. Well, he's been anointed by God to be king, but he's young and the time isn't right. So it's not time. He's got to wait. It made me think. And maybe it's a whole nother lesson. Talk. Has God anointed you for something? And maybe the time's not right just now, but has God anointed you for something? Because I believe that God has. I believe that God has plans for all of us, that we're all called for some reason, for a purpose. But maybe the timing isn't right now. And maybe you have to be patient. Maybe you have to wait on God. Maybe it will be coming. But we have to wait. There was a time in my life when I was swinging a hammer. I was doing construction, and I did not like it. I did not like it one bit. And I was doing construction, and I felt like, God, I know that you've kind of called me into ministry. I know that this is what I love to do. I was working with teenagers, and it was awesome, and I was enjoying it. But I was really limited to how much time I could do that because I had to make a living. I had to go to work. I had to do what I had to do. And for a long time, I kept saying, God, why? What's going on here? I want to do this. I'm interested in ministry. Prepare me. Send me. And I had to wait on God, and I didn't like it. I'm not a patient person. And eventually, obviously, things fell together, and I get to do what I get to do now. And I love it. But I had to wait for God's timing. Does God have a plan for you that you're having to wait for? How do you react to that? Do we react with patience, excitement, or do we get frustrated and annoyed? David, the anointed king, goes back to 10 sheep. Can you imagine what that would be like? Instead of a crown, he gets a crook or a shepherd's staff. How would we respond to that? Let's get back to Saul. God tells Saul he's going to fight the Amalekites and wipe them out. God tells him, you don't keep any plunder. You get rid of everything that has to do with the Amalekites. I want you to take care of them. And this is what happens. Then Saul slaughtered the Amalekites from Havilah all the way to Shur, east of Egypt. He captured Agag, the Amalekite king. That's not what God said to do. Very specifically, he said, take them all out. He captured the Amalekite king, but completely destroyed everyone else. Saul and his men spared Agag's life and kept the best of the sheep and the goats and the cattle and the fat calves and the lambs. Everything, in fact, that appealed to them, they destroyed only what was worthless or of poor quality. Are you seeing this? The disobedience that's happening, God was very clear. And there's this pattern. It's consistently happening with Saul. This is just one of the examples. And when we read it, we kind of, you know, because we're reading the story, when I read it anyway, I read the story and I think, oh, man, how dumb is this guy? You know, God's been really good to him and taking care of him. He goes to battle, and he wins battle after battle, and he does what he's supposed to do, and everything goes great. But when he doesn't do what he's supposed to do, things just fall apart. Why is that happening to Saul? Why does he do that? And we read that, and it's like, duh. But then part of me says, you know, I can kind of relate. If I look at my own life, I can kind of relate. There are things that I know God wants me to do. I want you to do this. And it's very clear in my head. This is what God has called me to do. And then I choose to go this way. Well, I kind of want to do my own thing, God. Surprise, there's consequences to that. It hurts. Sometimes it's very painful. We make choices and decisions, and it sucks sometimes. We're not doing what God has called us to do. It's not to say that things can't happen. You know, bad things can happen when you're doing the right thing. There's all sorts of stories that show that sometimes God uses that. But more often than not, when things are falling apart in our world, it's because of disobedience. It's because we're choosing our own way rather than God's way. And Saul is a perfect example of that. The very next verse. Then the Lord said to Samuel, I'm sorry I ever made Saul king, for he has not been loyal to me and has refused to obey my commands. Is that how God feels about me sometimes? In my disobedience? Man, I'm sorry I ever had him do that. That's not what I want. I want to be the man that God created me to be. I want to be the man that pleases God rather than the man that God looks at and goes, man, I should never have done that with Devin. I should never have let him be this or that or whatever. I don't want that to be. And this verse, it almost makes me sad. Then the Lord said to Samuel, I'm sorry I ever made Saul the king, for he has not been loyal to me and has refused to obey my commands. Samuel and Saul go on to talk about the bad things that the king has done. And Saul said, and this is where I hope that I differ. Saul says, I did what the king said. And you can almost see Samuel just shaking his head. It's like, you should know by now. I know what you've done. Here's the Devon paraphrase. What? I did what I was supposed to do. I did what God wanted me to do. Samuel says, well, then why do I hear all of these sheep and goats and cows? Well, we were gonna save those for sacrifice. Yeah, that's it. We were going to sacrifice those to God. That's what we were going to do. You can almost hear it. That's not how it really plays out, but that's what he says. Saul says, we're saving those for sacrifice to God. But Samuel says this, and I want to read it because I think it's pretty important. Samuel replied, what is more pleasing to the Lord, your burnt offerings and sacrifice or your obedience to his voice? Listen, obedience is better than sacrifice, and submission is better than offering of the fat rams. Obedience. Obey me is better than going to church. Obey me is better than religious traditions or rituals. Obey me is better than giving up meat on Fridays. It doesn't matter. Obey me, says God. That ultimately is what I want from you. Obey me. Obey me. Obey me. Saul and David, a couple of kings. So now Saul is in a real bind because God has removed his spirit from Saul. He's not blessing him any longer because of his disobedience. And so Saul becomes filled with anxiety, filled with fear. So without knowing how God has put this whole beautiful story together, it's interesting to me. Saul invites David to play music for Saul. Remember, David's just a boy. Saul doesn't know that David has been anointed king, but he invites him to play music for him, and sure enough, it calms down the tired old king. And then one day, Saul is facing a giant. Literally, a man who is said to be 9 foot tall. And he had this coat of mail, and I'm like, what's a coat of mail? So I looked it up. That's a coat, you know, the chain, the one that protects you from the sword. He has this coat of mail that's estimated to weigh 125 pounds. This is a big dude. I'm just saying. This is a massive man right here. And this giant, he's mocking Saul, the king. He's mocking the king. He's mocking all of Israel. And he's mocking God. And he stands before the people and he challenges them. Hey, you send your best warrior out to me, and if I win, that my whole army wins. But if your one guy defeats me, we'll be your slaves. Well, he's mocking everybody, and it's ugly. And David, still a boy, comes into the camp. He's bringing his older brother some food, some lunch. And he hears this giant, and he can't believe what he's hearing. He can't believe that they're allowing him to blaspheme God like that. And this is where we learn a little bit more about David. It says in chapter 17, don't worry about this Philistine, David told Saul. I'll go fight him. Don't be ridiculous, Saul replied. There's no way you can fight this Philistine and possibly win. You're only a boy, and he's been a man of war since his youth. But David persisted. I've been taking care of my father's sheep and goats, he said. When a lion or a bear comes to steal a lamb from the flock, I go after it with a club and I rescue the lamb from its mouth. If the animal turns on me, I catch it by the jaw and I club it to death. This guy's a stud, seriously. He's just a boy. I club it to death. I've done this to both lions and bears, and I'll do it to this pagan Philistine too, for he has defied the armies of the living God. The Lord who rescued me from the claws of the lion and the bear will rescue me from this Philistine. Saul finally consented. All right, go ahead, he said. May the Lord be with you.
Why are you here?
I'm here to see you, David.
The day that Saul rejected the Lord is the day that his kingdom was torn from him.
Send your best man to come down and fight. Defeat me, and all the Philistines will be your slaves.
Not one man in my army has had the courage to face him.
This is Goliath. You must come to your senses.
Much of that story is going to be very good, but that's a newer film. I know there's some Hollywood whatever ad-libbing and whatever into that, but the true story is found in 1 Samuel, and it's an epic story. I love the way that they blow it up and make it this hero. It really is that, and that's what really happened. You ever watching TV or a movie or whatever, and you find out at some point in the film that you didn't know before you watched it, but you find out this is a true story. This really happened. And for whatever reason, that just kind of makes it more intense and more real. This is a real story. It's a true story. I challenge you to read it this week in 1 Samuel. You won't regret it. We talked today, just kind of gave you the beginnings of this story, and at that, we just gave you the highlight reel, really. But we looked at the lives of two men. Looked at the lives of Saul, and we looked at the life of David. And my question for us, as you think about those two kings, those two men, who do you relate to more? Do you relate more to the life of Saul, who kind of does his own thing and wants to go his own way? Or do you relate more to David? Think about that for a moment. Let me remind you of the two key verses here. In chapter 16, it says, people judge by outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. How is your heart? How is your heart right now? If we're out to please people and make people happy with our actions and what we do, well then, our heart's more like Saul's is. But if we're out to please God, then we're more like David. If we're in a hurry and anxious and filled with anxiety and fear, it's probably more like Saul. But if it's patient, then it's more like David. The other verse is, obedience is better than sacrifice, and submission is better than the offering of the fat rams. If we're obedient, like David. But if we're obedient to self and what I want and what I do, then it's more like Saul. If we're fearful, Saul. Courageous, David. And our story, it has the potential to be an epic story. A story of a hero. It could be one of the things that films are made of. It's an epic story of a hero. And we may never remove the head of a Philistine, but we can face the giants and be victorious. I believe that. God has called each of us and anointed us for a purpose. How will we answer? Like Saul? Or like David?
Pray with me. God, thank you for the opportunity to be here today, to worship you today. God, I thank you for these friends and this family who are here with me to worship you, to grow closer to you. And God, we thank you for your word that we might grow closer to you through that, through this story specifically. God, help us to maybe pick up the book, pick up your Bible, your word to us this week, and read from it, that we might learn and grow even more. God, most importantly, I want to be more like David. Help me to be like David, putting you first, being obedient to you. That's our goal. That's our desire. We pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. Listen, we typically do communion on second Sundays. That was snowed out as well, so we're going to do that today. But we're going to do it a little bit different. I hope that you can stick around. In a few minutes, we're going to go ahead and get food, and we're going to arrange some of the tables in here so that you can go out there, fill up a plate.